Welcome to MindStand Pod, a series exploring workplaces and diving into cultures that make them tick. Each of our seasons will dive into unique factors of business, provide great stories from leaders in human capital, and offer helpful insights you can use today to impact your company.
Say hi to everyone, Leang.
Hey, it's so nice to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me to be part of this podcast. I'm excited to chat with you about this topic.
Absolutely. You know, just this idea of talent acquisition, you know, every CEO, every manager has to think about how they approach hiring, how they think about this idea of talent acquisition, which will lead into a positive culture. So really glad to have you here. How about this, you know, to introduce yourself to the guests, you know, who are you? What are you working on? What are you doing at Pelora Stack?
Yeah, so again, my name is Leang Chung. I am the founder and CEO of Pelora Stack, which is a company that I actually launched in the middle of COVID. And I spent, after spending over 15 years as a people ops talent and HR, both as a practitioner and a leader and senior advisor, I decided to take that expertise and build my own business where I can share this expertise with companies that are in need of it. In terms of where the business is focused on, we help underrepresented early stage founders and mid-career women prepare for what I call their first, the first time that they're scaling their organization, the first time that they're designing their company culture, the first time that they are building out their talent acquisition strategy and plan. For the women that I coach, I am working with women who are negotiating their salaries for the very first time. Perhaps some of them have been working for the same organization for 15 years and they're ready to make a move into a new company for the very first time. So it's really centered around this first experience. And the reason why I decided to focus on that first experience, that actually stems from my own upbringing. I experienced a lot of firsts in my own personal life, being the first person to graduate from college, the first person to have a corporate, to work in a, you know, a corporate job in an office with a salary versus an hourly wage. I realize how daunting those experiences are when you're going for the going through that first time of, you know, encountering that experience. And it's really difficult to navigate, especially when you don't have someone who is guiding you through that process. So I really wanted to lean in on that experience that I had growing up from my own personal upbringing and then apply it to my professional career and business to help other people who are going through their first.
That's special. Like you said, leading through experience. All of us, you know, whether we're first generation college students down to second time founders, everything is new. And you can imagine how much the remote world introduced these new ideas, these new opportunities. And I'm glad to see that you're able to create Pelora Stack, understanding how there's this new shift in the way we work, the way we think, and the way we hire. And you spoke on it a bit, talent acquisition, how you and your team at Pelora Stack has been able to help organizations think about hiring the best talent and ensuring that they can follow through with the culture of the company. So as one of the first questions, would love to know, what does talent acquisition mean to you?
Well, talent acquisition is everything that happens before a candidate joins your organization and officially becomes an employee, or when they just stay in that candidate pool process. It encompasses everything that's happening from, you know, how you're going out into the market and developing that brand awareness about your brand as an employer in the marketplace and what you have to offer. And it funnels through with what kind of experience that you want to offer to the candidates as they're going through that particular pipeline or through that recruiting funnel. How do they experience the company from every single touch point that they have, whether it's through your website, it's interacting with someone who's on your hiring team, to the social media presence that you have, your products, your services, all of those different components is part of that talent acquisition journey or talent acquisition experience. It also pertains to the different types of ways in which you're, managing that flow. So what are the different systems and tools that you have as part of the process? And then one of the pieces that is probably the most important aspect in my experience, because it's coming down to that very end. And it's so close to that decision-making process, which is who's on your hiring team? Who have you selected to be part of that group who's going to be evaluating and selecting candidates? And then what is that experience going to entail from an assessment perspective, from a conversation perspective, from an evaluation perspective to make a decision for the next hire at your organization.
Absolutely. And you said it's everything before they come into work for the first day, before they get their key fob. It's so important to be intentional about how you think about hiring, how you think about the first ideas that your pipeline, your talent pool have when they think about your organization. And have you seen in your work it be very custom to the company, to their organization, or have you found kind of unique or ideal characteristics? So ultimately, do you find 3 or 4 or 5 ideal characteristics when you're looking for candidates within organizations?
I think it's going to vary depending on not just the organization, but also the phase of the organization, the stage of their business. Someone who is looking to hire an employee for an early stage startup, for example, that has less than 10 employees may look for different qualifications or profiles versus a large enterprise business and who may be looking for someone who has a much deeper subject matter expertise in an area, whereas that early stage startup may be looking at someone who has expertise in a number of different areas and probably operates more as a generalist in that particular capacity, because that's what is most important at that particular stage. I think that the other thing that also plays a role in, how you determine or how a company determines what the ideal candidate looks like will be the type of culture that you have in place or that you want to design and establish internally. And so you may look at different qualifications that really speak to what it is that you want to have in place from a culture perspective. And then the other component is going to be the type of knowledge and background that you're looking for. Obviously they're being hired to perform a certain job or perform certain duties. And with certain roles, you're going to look for some things that could be non-negotiables in order to effectively perform that role. And so those are the 3 factors that I think really help determine what that ideal candidate looks like.
That makes sense. That makes sense. And, it requires, to your point, to look inward. What are you as the HR manager looking for in the future of the company? If you're to look at this organization 5 years down the line, is there a certain brand? Is there a certain performance metric that you're hiring for today to reflect those goals as well? It can't be one size fits all, but to what you've mentioned, there are characteristics, there are ideal factors that you're looking at when sourcing and looking at talent as well. So I'd love to know, diving a bit more into your work within Pelora Stack, how do you evaluate within companies and help them excel when they think about talent acquisition?
So since I predominantly work with clients who are in that early stage phase, so these are, they're at the seed stage, Series A, and the type of clients that I work with, they're, maybe they have 5 employees and they're scaling to 10, within the next few months. And it's, depending on the size of the organization, it may not necessarily look like large numbers, but it's a large number for them. It's the first time that they're growing in, with that level of significance. And at that stage, depending on the founder's background and experience in talent acquisition, it could range anywhere from help me develop a plan. How do I phase out? Do I hire everybody all at once or do I phase this out over time? And if I phase it out over time, what does that methodology look like? What is the logic that I should be applying as I'm looking at phasing out the hiring for people to join my organization. And then, from there, it could be, I know that I need somebody in marketing, but I'm not really sure. Should I hire an analyst or should I hire a manager? What do I actually need? And how is this person going to fit, within the rest of the organization? So those are the different things that we would look at. And then of course, doing the employer branding piece. So, how do you go out to the market? How do you sell? How do you present yourself? How do you compete with all the other big players that offer all these sexy perks and benefits, right? That you may not necessarily be able to afford at this time. And so how do you tell that employer brand story in the marketplace to be compelling and stand out?
Yeah, absolutely. It's fine. It's perfectly fine if you have no clue how to hire, the next 1, 2, or 20 employees. I think all too often, this idea of corporate leadership, especially in the startup world, there's a lot of things we're expected to know. There's a lot of things we're expected to be able to present on. But what you're saying is how you engage with the companies is understanding where they are, meeting them where they are, being open and creating that relationship so that you're able to create, like you said, the perfect talent acquisition plan. You're able to understand what hires you need versus the hires that you want maybe in the more short term. That's so excellent. And so, amazing work. A company that's been off the ground for the past couple months, thinking about the growth and expansion, would love to know, Liang, what do you believe, what are some of the lessons that you've learned so far? What do you believe you can teach the world, not only within talent acquisition and hiring, but just this idea of culture setting and leading through example?
That's a big question. What I have learned, I'm going to look at my experience being both an employee of an organization and how I took in that, the culture and the values, and then also in leading talent and culture for different organizations. I think, it is important to create an environment, whether that is the physical environment or the community that employees and people belong to, and create an environment where people feel that they matter and that they are seen and that they are contributing and adding value in some way. And then also, in looking at their future, it's, do I have a place here long-term? Do I see myself growing here? Do I see myself being supported in a way where I'm being set up to advance and set up to succeed? That's something that is incredibly important when I am evaluating a company that I'm thinking about joining when I'm a candidate myself. And it's incredibly important as a employee in how I experience that company and whether or not it's worthwhile for me to continue going and to stay and to invest my time in the company. I think that's one of the missed opportunities sometimes, is that companies are looking at it in, a one-sided way of like, well, we're here, we're providing all these things. And, why wouldn't someone want to stay? Because we have all these wonderful things to offer. Well, it's digging deeper into that statement and asking yourself and doing some reflection of, well, yeah, you may be offering all those things, but is it really addressing the needs of the people that work in your company? Is it really hitting on the points that are really meaningful and valuable to people? And that's always going to be a constant work. I don't think it can never be stagnant, because preferences change, needs change, right? And we saw that over the past 12 months where something completely unexpected occurred and it, you know, threw everybody for a loop. And people, you know, their lifestyles changed, their values changed, their needs changed entirely. And therefore, companies have to adapt to those changes to respond to it.
Absolutely. We saw it. Employers had to and needed to listen to their employees because they're not only relying on their organization for the compensation, but they're relying on them to reflect the values that they have, reflect the lifestyle that each employee, you know, contains. And it really sounds like there's a level of objectivity that you bring to the table, Liang. It's this idea of understanding and seeing the company's goals, their visions, but also giving them the insight to say, this makes sense. Your next 3 years, the strategies that you have are going to work well. Let me tell you how this is going to affect the 40-year-old mother of two in your organization. Exactly. The person who's working remotely from across the country, have you thought about how his experiences may play into the growth that you have as a leader? Does that sound correct? Would you call that your superpower?
Yeah. I guess, you know, I try to be really in tune to what I describe as the things that are being said and the things that are not being said, because you can also learn a lot from the silence in your organization. What are people not saying that is a cause or a point for reflection, and to be curious and dig into that a little bit more, because there's something there that people are trying to share or express themselves in a certain way, and it's a responsibility of employers to investigate that.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Liang. And as we wrap up, would love to know, when we think about hiring and talent acquisition, have you found tools, have you found exercises that you believe our viewers today could benefit from, a quick read, maybe a free trial? How do you think about equipping employers with tools for hiring and maintaining top talent?
So I think the first tool is selecting a really fantastic applicant tracking system or ATS system so that you're able to automate the process and then also put rigor and structure into how you're executing talent acquisition throughout that process. So I think that would be my first recommendation. And the other piece, just because I also have a focus and look at things from a DEI lens, diversity, equity, and inclusion lens, is looking at the recruiting operations. So these are all of the things that happen as soon as your applicant is applying for a role, and then they're going through that process from, you know, the initial phone screen to the onsite. Is paying attention to all of the nuances and all the little details in that process, because it really could either lean towards or help you achieve the diversity, equity, and inclusion goals or principles or strategies that you have in place, or it could, you know, move you further away from that entirely. And so that's another area that I, would advise and recommend to pay extra attention and caution to, is, to not just like speed through that process and be really mindful and thoughtful about how you're designing that and putting that together and how everything works, to ensure that you're creating a really wonderful candidate experience from, an inclusion perspective.
Yeah. And it's never too late, to what you've mentioned. You know, you may have hired the first 10 employees, or you may be just thinking about your first full-time hire. It's never too late and it's never too early to think about how to create, you know, a great structure around hiring and retaining top talent. Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Liang. In closing, would love to know, how can people reach you? What are some great ways to be able to interact with you and Pelora Stack?
Well, thank you so much for having me on your podcast and being a guest here. It's always, I always enjoy our conversation. So this is nice to be able to hit record this time. And in terms of like how people can stay in touch, I am on LinkedIn, so you can find me there. And I also have Pelora Stack listed. You can find me at LinkedIn or on Instagram as well.
Awesome. And so now I'm going to be asking for the first time this question that I'm sure I'm going to be asking over and over again. Thank you for being the first person, the first participant for this first episode. So I would love to know, Leang, do you know or do you think, could you think of one or two people that would benefit from becoming our next guest at the MindStand Pod?
I do have a couple of people in mind, so I will, I always like to check in with them to make sure that they're okay with the introductions first and they have their capacity, but yes, I definitely have, I actually have more than a couple of names for you, so I'm happy to share that with you.
Perfect. Perfect. Well, thank you so much, Leang. This was an amazing conversation, and I believe you provided some great resources that employers, CEOs, managers can take into action today to create a more inclusive and better work environment. Thank you.
Thank you.